Welcome back to Night Watch, where we're telling the story of the Iranian embassy siege in 1980 with news footage and dramatic reconstructions. 26 people are being held hostage by six Iranian terrorists at the embassy in central London. Police negotiators have established a rapport with the gunman and with it an air of calm. That calm, though, is suddenly threatened by a demonstration outside the building.
Some 80 Iranian students gathered behind police barriers, but well within earshot of the embassy, have been demonstrating their support for those being held inside.
The demonstration's potentially a dangerous situation that could be used to inflame the volatile situation within the siege itself, within number 16. The terrorists could have reacted in an unpositive way. They could have even started firing out the windows. Who knows?
There have been other chants too. Death to Carter. We are Allah's soldiers. We are Khomeini's soldiers. And so on. Many of the students are wearing white tunics made from sheets and bearing slogans like, "We will give our last drop of blood for the Ayatollah," in both English and Arabic. Ever-present outside the embassy, which has shown no lights all night, wait two ambulances, and there's a doctor close by. The negotiators, the marksmen and the watchers are in place. So now the police have settled into the routine that became familiar at Balcombe Street and at the Spaghetti House sieges, a routine which proved totally effective in both cases.
As the siege progressed, there were certain technical surveillance pieces of equipment used, some of them used in the walls, possibly in the ceilings, to monitor or try to monitor and get us any information that would prove vital to the success of this operation.
BBC Newsroom.
Hello, I'm Karkuti. I'm from the embassy. I'm a hostage. There is a short statement. The group occupying the embassy would like me to translate for them. The group occupying the Iranian embassy would like to assure the British public opinion that the British hostages, as well as all other non-Iranian hostages, will not be harmed. They would demonstrate that in a later stage, but the deadline for the safety of the other hostages and the others as well, which is 12 o'clock noon, is still valid. That's all.
May we ask you a question about the conditions in the embassy at the moment?
The gentleman here doesn't want me to answer any questions.
No more questions.
If he would like to talk to you, probably.
Hello?
Hello. Are all the hostages well?
All well and everything all right.
Is there anybody requiring a doctor there?
Yeah, we have an injured man. I think he's badly sick.
He's not suffering from gunshot wounds.
He injured, but I think it's not important how.
Can you tell me exactly how many hostages you're holding in the embassy there?
No, sorry.
Are they being held in one room, or are they tied up? Are they allowed to move about?
Sorry, I can't answer to this question too.
Have you received a telephone call during the night from the Iranian Foreign Minister, Mr. Gopsadi?
Not me, but the others. The other Iranian hostages.
There has been a phone call. What was the message?
The message, I think, he said we will not yield to the demands of the group.
What is your reaction to that message?
I think he will regret for this statement.
Can you go into details? What do you mean he will regret it?
I mean, after the deadline, we will kill everybody here, all the hostages.
Over 24 hours have elapsed since this incident started.
The gunmen inside the Iranian embassy must know that it is not within our power to meet all of their demands, whatever our views on the rights and wrongs of their cause may be. I appeal to them to remain calm. Hasty action may cause even more suffering to their own people in Iran. I feel deep sympathy for all the hostages in this time of stress.
All my officers engaged in this incident are concerned to do what we always try to do: resolve the situation without loss of life and uphold the law. We must show patience and perseverance.
On the following evening of May the 1st, we then got the word that things were deteriorating. So we moved undercover in four rented vans to a position in the back streets of Kensington, out of sight of the terrorist stronghold, and then we made our way across and through back gardens until we could gain access without being seen to number 14. On there we set up business, got organised, and this would be our home until the siege was busted on Monday, May the 5th. And it was from here that we did what we call target appreciation, going over everything in minute detail so that in your own mind you could carry out the assault without any further orders once the balloon went up.
The first team to arrive there generally set up what they call the immediate action, commonly known it throughout the regiment as the IA. What happens is the team arrives and they get the sketchy information that was available initially. That information is updated with all the latest information on site, where you tend to get a little bit more information. And then from there, they work out a plan which is due to be ready and operational within about 30 minutes of actually arriving on site. So you arrive there, pick up the information, do your recce's, reconnaissance on, you know, whatever the target was, in this case, Princess Gate. They go and do the reconnaissance. The team commanders then come back, get their men together, brief the team on how they see it going, tell each man what he's going to do on a formal briefing, and that is the first plan that is ever put together. Because we're in such a nice holding area, really, as far as holding areas we've been in before, you could actually get your hands on the news throughout the duration of the operation. There were things, televisions, books, telephones, all sorts of stuff. Snooker championships were on at the time, World Snooker Championships were on at the time. The actual overall feeling was one of the excitement: will it or won't it happen? Are we ever going to be used? You know, we've got the chance this time, but will we be allowed to do it? Not once in the 6 days did we have our black uniform off. Everything was on. That is, as I stand now, gas masks very close by, weapons, body armour, everything would be on you, or certainly within arm's length at all times, should the IA be called upon, that you could react immediately to it. Everybody on the immediate action at this time would have had a bullet in the chamber in the MP5 and any other weapon, including the 9mm pistol. It'd be in the chamber, loaded and made ready at all times. The only thing would, you'd have the safety catch on.